We want to wrap up day one with a very, very fascinating session. And I have just had the privilege of spending a few minutes with all the speakers of this session. Apart from the moderator, who's extremely dynamic, and he's going to set the stage on fire from what I can understand. We have two or three interesting entrepreneurs whose ideas may not seem like big billion-dollar ideas, but trust me, if you hear their numbers and the speed at which they are growing, you will be convinced. If you hear about their business, it'll sound like, what the heck, why are they into this, what are they doing? But if you listen to their passion and kind of share their vision, I think you all will be convinced that India has the richest pool of entrepreneurs who are thinking uniquely, thinking differently. One such example, and I'm sure he'll be introduced to you, is a guy who is selling momos worth 20 crores. Is that right, Sagar? Where are you? Yeah, there you are. So you will hear from him. And he's not even in Bombay as yet. So we'll invite him to Bombay very soon from Calcutta. But it's a pleasure to introduce the next session, the next billion-dollar ideas, breakthrough concepts that are putting the Zing back in retail. I felt the Zing never went away, Rahul. So maybe you can prove me wrong. I thought the Zing was always there.
Now, this session is about innovation and creativity. So my request is, let's keep it light. Let's keep it energetic. Let's not keep it very serious. I know this is almost the end of the day. And you've gone through a lot of sessions before this. Okay. I just like to start off with a quick show of hands. How many entrepreneurs in this room right now? Wow. Okay, that's almost 50% of the room. How many of you believe you've got a billion-dollar idea with you? That's 50% of the 50%. And what prevents people like me from realizing that dream? Okay, I'll tell you a little joke. It's in Hindi. If you don't understand Hindi, don't ask for a translation. एक दिन आप प्लेन ने रॉकेट से पूछा कि भाई तू इतना फास्ट कैसे जाता है रॉकेट मुड़ के बोला जिस दिन तेरे पिछवाड़े में भी आग लगेगी ना तू भी ऐसे ही उड़ेगा सो बॉयज एंड गर्ल्स आई एम वेरी हैप्पी टुडे टू इंट्रोड्यूस टू यू नॉट वन बट सिक्स रॉकेट्स एंड वन मेंटर ऑन स्टेज व्हाट यू हैव ओवर हियर इज नॉट जस्ट सिक्स एंटरप्रेन्योर्स बट व्हाट यू आर स्टेयरिंग एट इज पोटेंशियली $6 billion ऑन स्टेज एंड दैट आई थिंक डिजर्व्स अ स्मॉल राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज Okay, the way we're going to start the session is that I'm going to put up a picture over here and I'm going to have each of these gentlemen over here talk about their idea and introduce it in not more than 1 or 2 minutes. There are two parts to it. One, what is your idea? Two, why do you believe you've got a billion-dollar idea? So here goes the first one and I've got the beer cafe on.
Billion-dollar idea for sure, a billion-rupee idea right now. It's going to transform into $1 billion very soon. So what is a beer cafe? So I'll just give you a mashup. If you look at certain statistic, India is the third largest liquor consumption in the world. One out of all five liquors in the world are consumed in this country. So we're definitely very spirited if you look at it that way. If you look at it from a beer's perspective, beer is the third largest consumed beverage in the world after water and tea. What's happening in the retail space in India is the cafe culture. So if you look at it from a cafe culture, it already exists. For the last 15 years, we've seen a lot of cafes, and that's been a static component. What we've done at the beer cafe is merge the two. So we merged alcohol beverage into a cafe concept, and that's what we are. So we are now India's largest alcohol beverage chain, and that's the white space that we're addressing.
What makes you a billion-dollar idea?
What makes our idea big is consumption, for sure. If you look at it, like I said, after water and tea is the world's third largest consumed beverage. Asia has become the, not the last frontier, but the biggest frontier for beer. 65% of all the beers in the world is now consumed in Asia. In Asia alone, after China and Japan, India is the third largest consuming nation when it comes to beer. So it is a social lubricant. We consider beer as a social lubricant. We consider beer as something that brings people together. It's a drink which really enables a meeting place. It's a drink you can go in your neighborhood and drink. It's a very easy on your pocket, it's easy on your health. And that's where, so the consumption automatically makes this idea big. And that's what we're trying to address here.
Mr. Pronto, Abhishek.
Okay. Mr. Pronto is India's only shoe repair chain. We don't just repair shoes and bags. We can repair any leather item, baby strollers, horse saddles. We can make people look taller. We can fix leg length discrepancy. But more than that, just fixing shoes, we fix lives. We actually bring people from the pavement, train them on our machines, take them directly to a mall, and eventually make them franchise owners. So it's a complete process that we use. We use the company-owned franchise-operated model. So that's what we do.
And what makes you a really big idea? I love that picture on the left over there, the shoes, and they look almost as good as new. Talk to us about that.
So we clean shoes, we repair shoes, and those shoes look good.
Okay, yatrachef.com. Yes, so working.
Assuming most of you get to eat whatever the providers give you. So that's what's happening right now, and lots of people travel in train. Okay, so what Yatra Chef does is, we are a marketplace of restaurants who are serving the passengers of Indian Railways. So what we do is, any passenger who is traveling can order through Yatra Chef from any of the popular restaurants and route your journey. And when the train reaches the station, the food will be delivered at your seat. And that's basically what Yatra Chef do, and that's giving out a new customer experience to the really bad experience right now. So, yeah.
Why do you call the current experience bad? No, I've got a set of pictures over there, which are fascinating. Yeah. It's quite disgusting,
yeah,
actually.
This is what usually happens when you have food from train. And I am actually a victim of this, and that's how the whole Yatra Chef thing started. The train, actually the vendors take you for granted. So basically you get to have whatever they deem is good for you. They have just two cuisine options, veg and non-veg. So basically you get to have whatever the chef thinks is good, whatever he fancies for that day. Through Yatra Chef, and this is what we got inspired from, because there was no avenue for anyone to have food, I mean good food or your favorite food or anything. As in, there are lots of cuisine. I have heard that there are almost 5,000 cuisines. And so what we try to work is bring all this cuisine, get to have your favorite food in train. And that's what we try to give you. We have association with over 300 restaurants right now across 135 stations in India. And that's pretty much what Yatra Chef is.
Fantastic.
So, what we do is, I think we add color to India. We feel that we have the world's youngest, population, and we feel that Indian consumers today at the 18 to 25 aren't afraid to wear India on their sleeve. We haven't had much options in, you know, the entire design in India kind of product. And we thought that we could take design as a platform and take it on to product design and, you know, cater to consumers' needs in the 18 to 25 age group.
How many of you guys have ever owned a Chumbak phone case or a pouch or a tea? I've got three of them. Okay. Wow, Momo. The fascinating idea that...
Hi, good evening. As you can
about.
See, this is a Wow Momo kiosk, and you can see the nice queue outside the kiosk. This speaks for itself. By God's grace, we are currently the country's largest Momo chain with 41 outlets in the east and south of India. We're there in Calcutta, Bangalore, Pune, Chennai, and Cochin as of now. We began this venture 6 years ago with an investment of only 30,000. Today, by God's grace, as Sir said, we are doing a 20 crore turnover. So that feels proud. That feels really great. Our business model is being studied in a few B schools also. Moving to the next picture, what made us wow was that it's all about innovation, you know, product innovation. We've literally played with momos. I mean, when we started Wow Momo, steam momos were available everywhere. we played with momos. We came up with fried momos. We came up with pan-fried momos, where the momos are fried and tossed in our own specially prepared sauces. We wanted momo to be like a full meal, so we came up with a momo burger, where we serve 2 pieces of fried momo stuffed in the burger bread with our own sauces. So, you know, you make your momo a meal, you buy a steam momo, you add $55, you get a Pepsi, and you make a momo burger out of it. We want to do something more different, so we came up with sizzler momos, where we serve 6 pieces of momo, which is sizzled and served. So, you know, if one customer is buying it, another customer is seeing it, even he wants to buy it. Ultimately, jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. So, you know, I mean, we wanted a dessert in our menu, so we said we'll create a chocolate momo. If it has to be a dessert, it has to be a momo. So we've just played with our product. We've done simple things with style, and I think that's what has made us wow momo. Thank you.
Okay. Just a quick show of hands, and I'd like to make a point over here, is to ask you that how many of you had any experience in the line of business that you operate in right now? Just a quick show of hands. How many of you had any experience? Okay, no one's putting up their hands, so I'm going to ask a question differently. How many of you had no experience at all in the line of business? And that is fascinating, because you're sitting and watching 6 people here with billion-dollar ideas, and they've had absolutely no experience. Okay, and it brings us back to the entire point of it all being about the power of a fascinating idea. Okay, over to you, Abhishek. And I'm going to ask you, how did you come up with the idea of setting up shoe and bag repair stores in fancy malls? We've never seen that before. So what prompted you to come up with that?
Well, during my B school days in the Philippines, I saw it work there. And I clearly saw a market gap in India. When the market gap, there was also an empty consumer mind space that I wanted to fill with my brand.
Tell me something, for something like that, because you know there's no data available around an unorganized sector like cobblers, right? So how do you go about sizing up an industry like yours, and how do you figure that it's fairly meaningful and it's going to be remunerative for you? How do you go about doing that?
My target market is people with shoes, with men who wear shoes worth 1500 and above. And, you know, we can ask the audience how many shoes they have at home that needs a good fix. I'm sure most of you have shoes. Raise your hands who has shoes worth 1500 and above. There you go.
There's nobody who would not have raised his hand at that question. I said, no, my shoes cost only $600. Yeah, I'm here. I just paid $25,000 to get in here, but my shoes cost only $350. Okay. Arun, I've got a question for you, and this again has to do with sizing up the market opportunity. 8 billion people travel on the Indian Railways, and that is more than the world's population. I'm going to repeat that for you. 8 billion people travel on the Indian Railways. That is higher than the world's population. How do you go about sizing up your opportunity?
Yeah, 8 billion. Yeah, when we first started Yatra Shiv, even we were skeptical about the size of the travelers of Indian Railway. It's 8 billion, it's more than six times, no, almost seven times the population of India itself. So, it is actually true. There are lots of people who travel in India. It's actually the lifeline of India. Railways is the lifeline of India. And 8 billion, as far as we've seen, it's not a huge number. Even 8 billion isn't a huge number, because there are almost 30% are ticketless travelers, which aren't even accounted for. And in that 8 billion, what we look at is a 150 million people who book their ticket online. That equates to almost 5 lakh tickets online. That is our core customer base. That is the customer base which we are targeting, because they are... they know how to use an internet. They book their ticket online. So we are an online marketplace as well. So if we can capitalize on these 5 million odd passengers, it's a big thing.
Okay, Sagar, I'm going to come to you. And you're all about food. So tell me, what's your magic ingredient? You've got some superb innovations. You've spoken about some of them. Can you tell us a little more?
It's all about innovation. I mean, in today's world, even if you want to propose a girl, you have to be innovative. That's my experience. It's all about innovations.
But do they come to your stall and propose?
Yeah.
Let me take you for a date to wow momo and propose to you. Do they do that?
Just make her have momo, then she'll be yours. we've always focused on the innovation aspect. We've always focused on, you know, like I said, you know, jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. You need to be seen. You need to show yourself. Today, when you're a new brand, people need to know you. People need to know what you're doing. So you need to create an impression in the mind of the consumer. And you can only do that by doing simple things with style. I mean, don't do very fancy stuff, no rocket science. For example, you know, when it's Independence Day or Republic Day, we serve momos with a tricolor sauce. We anyway serve it with a green sauce and a red sauce. We just add a new white sauce to it. So it's innovating. On Valentine's Day, we serve our chocolate momos in a heart-shaped format. So, you know, it's again showing the sign of love. So it's again innovating with an occasion. So it's just creating that impression on the mind of the consumer, from your product to your packaging to the way your look and feel is. You know, I mean, make your store look bright. So it's always been about innovation for us, and that's how we've played with it.
Fantastic. Okay, what we've spoken about over the last 5 or 7 minutes, or the last 10 minutes, of course, is how do you come up with a great idea? How do you come up with a big idea? I'd like to bring Daryl on right now to talk to us about what makes an idea big, and how do you execute a big idea and make it even bigger? So I'll control the slides for you if you'd like, and yep, there you go.
Thank you. What we've heard so far is we've got one colleague who sells beer. I've got a colleague who fixes shoes. I've got two colleagues who sell food. What's new? Aren't there thousands of those people out there? But what makes this different are these things we call the E's. And this is about the oldest thing that I know in retail, and I've been doing it for four decades, but it's also becoming the newest thing. What makes the difference? I'll just quickly take you through. Engage the customer. Statistically, you have 2.4 seconds to stop the passing customer and get them interested, whether it's your website, whether it's your storefront, whether it's your kiosk. 2.4 seconds. Following on from that 2.4 seconds, you need to get them excited. They need to have some interest in what you are doing, whether it's your color, whether it's your logo, whether it's the use of technology. Customers still like to be entertained. When I was about 8 years old, my mum and dad would take my sister and I in the family car up to the city to the big department store, and we would see things we'd never seen before in our lives. Not everything was for sale, but it would excite and entertain us. You have to appeal to emotions. If you've got a good product, but you stand in a queue for 40 minutes, you've ruined the experience. We've got educate. Customers like to learn things. They learn to be exposed to things they didn't know when they first arrived, and you have efficiency. So you can look at retail now in two separate ends. In terms of efficiency, if you take an example of the supermarket or the convenience store, people want to be able to get in, make their purchase, pay and leave and be home. On the other end is, you want to keep them in your store, in your business longer, because they enjoy being there. Can we show a couple of short clips?
Videos?
Yeah, the one on efficiency is important. My favorite retail group in terms of technology right now is Tesco's. And they're really looking at things for a whole new perspective. So the first one just shows you two little snippets. It shows you how they're trying to make shopping in the supermarket more efficient, and they're showing you how they're using efficiency within operations of their business. It's only about 30 seconds.
I'm terribly sorry, I'm having some technology issues over here.
Ah, so do I, because I'm old.
Can I show you the other videos first?
Yes, sure. Which one are you showing?
So let me just, sorry guys, I use a different computer, I use a Mac, and some of the videos are not compatible. So I'm going to show you. Can I show you Adidas first?
Yep, you show anyone, I can talk to it. Okay, this is not about efficiency. This is putting technology back into bricks and mortar.
My name is Chris Aubrey with Adidas. Welcome to the Adiverse. To help the consumer find the shoe they want, we created a unique virtual footwear wall, Adiverse. Adiverse puts the ultimate aisle of shoes at the fingertips of the consumer while they're in store and ready to buy. So let's take a look at how it works. Adiverse is an interactive and intuitive experience. As the consumer approaches, the Adiverse wall detects their movements and plays eye-catching graphics. Using anonymous video analytics, Adiverse then determines gender to recommend an ideal product range. Now they select one of the existing shoes or begin a search based on their personal preferences. Choosing a shoe, Adiverse lets them freely rotate the shoe and view it from any angle to check out the shoe in great detail. This allows them to experience the shoe without actually having it present in the store. To give the consumer the additional information they need in order to buy, we give them the ability to find out more through the interactive interactive menus. Technology, which gives product benefits. Story, which gives the background of the shoe. And buzz, which connects the Adiverse wall to the social media world to find out what others are saying about the shoe. Armed with all the information they need, the consumer is now ready to buy.
What Adiverse set out to do was to give people a reason to interact in the store, to learn more. But did you hear what he said? He said, this means we don't have to carry stock. If you were buying a new pair of shoes, what would you want to do? Try it on? So I don't understand the concept. I understand the bit about the education, but I think sometimes we take technology too far. So he could have had the stock in the store still and allowed the consumer interaction. Have I got another one that we can?
Yep. So I'm going to play Pepsi right now.
That's my mistake. Sorry.
What's interesting with this is Pepsi are actually advertising on the outside. But what they're saying is, whilst you wait for that bus, can we give you an experience? Hardly anybody just arrives at the bus station and gets straight on the bus. So they're trying to engage, give these people a memory. Did you notice when the tiger came down the street that there was a young man with his girlfriend on the bench? Did you see the young man jumped up to run away and left his girlfriend behind? Interesting observation. But you imagine that technology going into the retail store. You could put those at the checkouts. If you do have a queue backup, you could be entertaining, you could be selling things at the same time. So this is what I'm saying, the businesses that these guys are going into are making hugely successful in themselves are not so unique. But their attitude to engaging people, exciting people, entertaining people, those are the things that make them unique. And that's very hard to do, and it's very hard to sustain once you start.
I've got Tesco coming up, is that good? Yep.
Hi, I'm Mike McNamara. I run technology for Tesco. I'm here today in Romford Store to show you some of the innovations that we've been creating for our colleagues and for our customers. Well, when you walk into the store, this is the first innovation you see. It's called Scan As You Shop. Customers love it. Very simple system. You put your club card, scan your club card here, pick up one of these hand scanners. It mounts in the trolley, and then actually as you go around the store, you just scan your shopping straight into the bags that you'll put in the boot of your car. It skips out that whole process at the checkout. Customers absolutely love it. every week across Tesco, we change between 5 and 10 million shelf-edge labels. That's an awful lot of labels and takes an awful lot of manpower to do it, but no more. The future is electronic shelf-edge labels. These are ones that we've developed using the same technology that's in the Amazon Kindle, and that will, they're going out to Hungary this year. The other great advantage of electronic shelf-edge labels is that you can change prices instantly. So, you know, if we wanted to change the price of all these products, it'd take us a week to do it right across Tesco. With electronic shelf-edge labels, we can do it within the hour.
So it would take them a week under the manual system. They can do it in 1 second. In 1 second. On the shopping trolley, that technology has now been superseded as well. You don't have the hand wand. When you put the goods in the trolley, it automatically scans. When you go past a module end and it's selling thumbs up, buy two, get one free, it will tell you. It will also tell you from your loyalty card what you bought on your last shopping trip. And if you're passing cereal and you haven't stopped and put cereal, it will say you bought cereal last time. When you get to the checkout, you process yourself. You go into a corral, the data gets downloaded, you put your card into the ATM machine, it debits your account, the door opens and you leave the store. Efficiency, because nobody likes to spend a lot of time in the supermarket. And the bus shelter is all about entertainment. I think what these gentlemen are telling us is, either by brilliant planning, genius thinking, maybe even by accident, they actually are doing these sorts of things, and that's what makes their businesses unique.
Fantastic. Thank you, Darren. Okay, I'm going to switch gears now, and I'm going to come to a fairly important question, which is, what comes in the way of a big opportunity and a big idea? Okay. And Rahul, I'm going to start with you, and I'm going to put you on the spot over here, and I'm going to ask you a slightly difficult question. Government policy and archaic laws, especially in an industry like yours, alcohol, okay, they can be quite frustrating. Has this impacted your business?
You sound like Arnab Banerjee, actually.
I'm going to put the pen back in the pocket.
No, it's a compliment. Retailers, we all know that it's three words that we always use, location, location, location. In our business, it's also three, another word, we call them regulation, regulation, regulation. And the only thing I look forward to not seeing in the newspapers is another Kerala happening. So that's one of those doomsdays for me that, you know, it comes back and Kerala is getting prohibited. So that's something, you know, we don't look forward to. But under Constitution 47 of India, liquor is a state policy, so each state to their own. It's not a central policy. Each state can do what they want to do. So, for example, Mizoram was prohibited just last year. They went wet, if you want to, so from dry. Gujarat is still dry, but wet otherwise, but dry officially. And so we do have these regulations, each state to their own. India is a huge, huge continent in its own way when it comes to it. And that's what prevents us, to kind of... So the acceleration sometimes gets defeated because of the regulations, but that's a choice we've already made. We made a choice to be in the business of alcohol beverage, and so be it. And that's what we are here for, work around the regulations and make our stores and make our consumers get what they really want.
How big is your business today?
So we have 15 outlets which are pouring. We have 10 outlets about to pour. When I say about to pour, meaning they're completely ready in physical form and in staff. We're waiting for our licenses. Two states have gone into a code of conduct because Maharashtra and Haryana, as you know, is having elections on 15th of October. So before and after elections, we get a kind of a curfew period, and that's not allowing us to get some licenses. 15 more outlets in the pipeline, so we'll be 40 outlets by March of 2015.
How big will you be about 3 years from now? I heard some projections of yours, and this is fascinating.
So we've quadrupled this year from 15 to 60 crore. Next year from 60 to 120. So 2 years from now, it'll be 300 crores for sure.
You're looking at 300 crores. Yes. Fascinating. Yes. Wow. Okay. Yeah. Abhishek, I'm going to come to you now. What comes in the way of big opportunity? Your business is all about unskilled labor. It's about cobblers. Sourcing the right talent for a business like yours, has that gotten in the way of growth for you?
Well, my entire company is configured to keep them into my system. So therefore, we are the best paymasters for this kind of labor, which is typically 8 standard pass or below. And once they reach a certain scale, we even have plans for making them company-owned franchise operators. The difficulty lies in retaining professionals like accounts professionals, material managers, franchise professionals. And I typically don't want to, you know, spoil the equilibrium by paying extra. So the challenge is right there.
Okay. I want to talk to you guys a little bit about what's changed in the environment that's made your business possible. Okay. I'm talking about the penetration of the internet. I'm talking about social media. I'm talking about the increasing penetration of modern retail formats and so on. A lot of your businesses, I am guessing, would not have been viable 10 or 15 years ago. And it's only the changing environment that's brought about these new ideas and these ideas that are growing rather rapidly. Rahul, what's been the impact of the internet and social media on your business? I mean, yours is not an internet business, but you speak about the fantastic impact.
Well,
no, sorry, that's for Rahul.
I got confused. I got a clone here. Okay. So internet is an option for marketers usually. You know, for us, it's in compulsion. Because when you look at it, we can't advertise on television, we can't advertise on print media and radio for that matter. What do you surrogate beer with, you know, so it kind of gets a little more difficult. So for us, internet is the media to reach out. It's actually a very strong medium of marketing for us. And within the internet, obviously social media plays a lot. So to give it a point, the amount of social media we've used for our, reaching out to the consumer and engaging it. So far the social media was a one-way street. We would reach out to customers or reach out to our target audience. Now we've, thanks to a company called Snapline, we've gone into something which we proprietored on our own called Brew Miles, which is where people can actually now scan their own rewards and redeem, and so they can now earn and burn on the same platform. So it's a social media platform in a way because it's still on a smartphone, and from that phone itself they can do all the transactions literally. So we've gone on that, you know, it's kind of a leapfrog from our loyalty program. So gone are the plastic days, gone are the reward coupons days. Everything for us is on the phone now. And that's where we feel a consumer is sitting. He's on the phone, he or she is a screenager. They look at the screen almost their entire living lives. They're always looking at a screen. And that's what our consumer is. So we've gone very aggressive on social media and on the screen.
Wow, fantastic. Okay, Vivek, you've been terribly quiet, and that's because I haven't asked you a question. So here goes. And what I'm going to ask you is that modern retail and online retail, would your business even have been viable or possible without these two?
No, for sure. I think from day one, we figured that we'd be a hybrid kind of model. And today, with the kind of efforts that we put into offline, first, because we honestly feel that offline is tougher to do in today's day and age than online with the kind of competition and kind of monies that you spend. A lot of people figure that online is easier to do or, you know, cheaper to do. So what we figured that let's put all our efforts into putting up stores. So today we have about 25 of them, growing about 8-10 a month now. And online, I think we've been very active on social. And India, as we've seen in the morning also, both Kunal and Amit are talking about how the growth has happened. And we've seen that today, even like a social media channel like Facebook, today Facebook contributes to about 25% of my online revenue and growing month on month. And so I think we've always known that it would be a hybrid model.
Wow. You spoke right now, and very briefly, you said that I have 25 stores right now. How long have you been in operation? 3 years, right?
Yeah, just over about 3.5 years.
You've been around for 3 years, and you have 25 stores right now. And then you say that I am growing at the rate of 8 or 10 stores a month.
Yep.
So that means what? You're going to double in the next 3 months? So what you've done in the last 3 years?
Should have about 70, 80 by the end of the year.
And what's essentially fueling this growth? Because what you've done for the last 3 years.
I think...
Is there a tipping point that I'm...
Yeah, I think we're hitting a... We work with a very kind of experimental kind of model. We try out stuff, perfect it, and then just go scale it. So while we've got the smaller format kiosks that we've opened in about 25 locations today, we've understood that model and said that this is what we're scaling. This month, we opened two really large stores, one in Bangalore and one in Delhi, which are 10x the size of what we typically work with. And again, it's an experiment for 2 months and then scale that up. I think we work very differently in the sense that we work quietly. We don't talk about this kind of growth that we're having. So such that there's no pressure. So that's, I think, is something that we have fun with.
Wow. Sagar, I'm going to move to you and ask you this question. You don't advertise at all, right? Conventional advertising, above the line advertising. You don't do any of that at all. Would you say that modern retail formats and modern trade have actually built your brand? You know, and that's what's actually helped you go from a 30,000 crore revenue brand to a 20 crore revenue brand. What's the impact of modern trade?
I mean, imagine opening a kiosk for 30,000 rupees. How was that possible? It was with the advent of modern retail that we could grow. I mean, we opened our first kiosk of a 36 square feet, 6x6, inside Spencer's Retail. It was a shop-in-shop kiosk inside a hypermarket. So in hypermarkets, you have no deposits to pay. They treat you as a concessionaire. So, you know, your investment is low, your capex is low. Just put your steamers, have a nice menu, start selling. That's how we began. So modern retail has played a very big, it's played a pivotal role in our growth, you know, from hypermarkets to malls to food courts to tech parks to multiplexes. We're there everywhere, you know, and that's been a very, very key aspect for our growth. So definitely modern retail has played a big part. To add to that, what has really worked in our favor is the kind of TG that we play with. I mean, we've been lucky enough to have a very wide TG. For momos, you know, it's got a very, very wide TG. You know, kids love momos. A girl who wants to remain slim and trim will always have momos because it's healthy. Elderly person will have momos because it's oil-free. So we go from the youth to child to an elderly person. So in our product line, we've been lucky to have a very wide TG. So having a very wide TG, a very wide population catchment, as well as the advent of modern retail, opening of more and more malls, more and more hypermarkets, multiplexes, both have played a very key role in our growth, I would say.
Fantastic. In general trade, you won't have a kiosk, you're a chaos, total chaos over there.
Yeah, I didn't get you.
Okay. Rahul, I'm going to come back to you now, and I'm going to talk about funding. And I know that you've raised some institutional funding, and that's played a critical role in your business. We all now know how important it is to get that institutional funding or any type of funding at the right point in your business, okay, to be able to attract at the right point in your business, and also to be able to attract it at a point where your business is robust enough so that you're not diluting too much equity. Talk to us about your experience with raising finance or raising equity to fuel your business.
First of all, a challenge that usually entrepreneurs face, and the entrepreneurs here, and I'll give you that because I failed many times before, you know, getting into this one. So one of the things is in the restaurant, the food service business, one of the most successful models is a person who runs an ODP restaurant. And the reason for that is that person is sitting behind the desk, he's scanning his staff, he's scanning the customers, he's giving you absolute, you know, complete attention, and he's always there for you. So it's a single station ODP restaurant. Similarly, in the alcohol beverage business, if you go across the globe, you have bars which are run by generations. So the grandfather ran it, the father ran it, my son's running it. Again, a very personalized business. Now, we started with one outlet. It was easy to be, you know, on there, on the floor, and, you know, handle your customers and engage with them. But the challenge happens if you have four or five outlets. Now you got five outlets, and we met five outlets without any funding. And when we reached the five outlet, we are under this sector called the SME. You know, now from a single pop and warm store, you're a five outlets, you're a small medium enterprise. And one of the issues with small medium enterprises, you have to follow all the compliances. Now you're following all the compliances, you're filing your tax, you've got audits going on, you're a private limited company, and now you're burning whatever you're earning in all the compliances, because in this country, you actually end up spending a lot of time and money complying for the government. Now, if you have 100 outlets, you kind of can, you know, optimize your returns. So with 100 outlets, you don't need that kind of, you know, you will need the compliance, but you'll have a whole corporate setup. Talent is the biggest issues with any SMEs. I couldn't get talent at all when I started off with one or two outlets. For an entrepreneur, that's the biggest challenge. So if you work in, you know, Fortune 500 companies, which is where I also worked in, it was very easy to get talent. Talent was just sucking us. Whereas here, I would literally going out to get talent. So what it does is you have to think big, you know. You can act small, but you have to think big. And that's where the funding actually came in. I can tell you, be very honest, if I had not got the funding, I wouldn't be sitting here. 5 outlets, 10 outlets, do not cut it. It's just you're there, but you're not really there. SME is a very tough battle to win. I've been in that stage. You really burn a lot. You have to think big. You have to go in. Now, think big. Unfortunately, the ecosystem in India does not allow you debt. So I went to a bank and he says, okay, I'll give you 10 crores, but you need a collateral. So I said, if I had the collateral, why would I come to you? I would be playing golf. I won't be sitting here. So, you know, how do I manage that? We don't have an ecosystem that you can go to the government and they're going to, you know, give money to entrepreneurs. So either it's family and friends, and or otherwise it's you have to seek out institutional funding. So funding at the right time, like you said, Rahul, is extremely important. You have to find that right time. Do not worry about diluting your stake. It's about, do you want to be 10% of 100 crore or you want to be 100% of a 10 crore? Both are the same arithmetic, but you have to make a choice. So if you're thinking big, your 100 stores, 200 stores can take you to $1 billion, I would say go for the funding. And there is enough out there. There's enough institutional funding out there. I can tell you, India is back in the boom. There is a situation that I've met so many funds over the last 6 months because we've gone through our second round. And I've just realized they're looking for good people. They're looking at people in their eyes and looking at entrepreneurs and saying, come on, man, stand up and say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to take it to whatever I want to take it to. And the funding is there. So it's a runway they create. At the end of the day, you have to fly. The funding only gives you a runway. They're not going to fly for you. So you have to find the right fund who gives you the robust runway, and then you're ready to fly. And that's where my funding experience comes from.
You and I need to have a conversation later. Abhishek, the exact opposite. You've not sought any funding. I know you've been in a couple of conversations before. What would it take for you to entertain a good proposal and move to those 300 stores?
Well, I have gone to banks and banks. Debt funding, I do have. But
I'm talking about equity. And I'm talking about equity.
Yeah, equity. Yeah, but So plan A was to set it up all by myself with a little bit of debt. Okay, but my newest business strategy is to find investors as well as franchisees. But unlike others, I must ensure they're not the same person. My franchisees have to be the lowest level people because those are the only people who will sit at the store and serve the customer. And once they feel that it's their store and their customer, that's when the job is done best. After all, I am as good as the hand of my technician.
As good as the hand of your cobbler. Yeah. Okay. Sagar, now you've grown to 20 crores, and I know that you haven't attracted any funding, or I'd like to rephrase that, you haven't sought any funding, okay? And you've grown rather organically. What's your take on this?
We've totally grown by blowing back of profits. Funding is definitely important to take yourself to the next level, but what is more important is getting the right valuation at the right time. If you're confident of your business model, today we are able to generate a lot of debt and we are able to service our debt very comfortably. We have a debt of over 1.5 crores from bank through CCs, through the CGTMS scheme of government. It is a bit of a pain, but then, you know, getting those, going through that pain of getting your banking in place, getting your documentation in place also teaches you a lot. You know, as a startup, your systems come into place with it. So like they say, you know, no gain without pain. I would say funding, definitely PE funding is important, but as long as you can grow by yourself and get your valuations up and that doesn't hinder your growth, I think you should wait and wait for the right time to before letting out stake if you're confident of your business model, which I guess we are.
I got it. Okay. I want to move over to pretty much the last section of this talk right now. And what I'd really like to do is, and I'm sure a lot of people would also like to seek answers to this, is that we'd like to get into the minds of the entrepreneurs who come up with these billion-dollar ideas, okay? So I'm going to ask you some quick questions. Rahul, first to you. I know that you have failed thrice before, okay? And now you've come upon a really successful model. So talk to us about your willingness to fail. A lot of us are not willing to fail, okay? And are very scared of failing. And you're learning from past failures.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong in, you know, fearing from failure because, you know, nobody wants to fail. But it happens. It happened to me too. I'm a textile engineer, you know, selling beer, so it's a complete chalk and cheese when it comes to it. But, you know, I was a professional till 2006, earning a fancy salary, 9-to-5 job, really living the good life. But for me, the bigger regret would have been not being an entrepreneur than being an entrepreneur and failing.
You know, it's a very cliched one, but at the age of 60, I would have looked back, and if I had not been an entrepreneur, that would have been a very, you know, kind of a sad moment for me. So having failed is easy. Failure actually teaches you a lot. It gets you to meet with a lot of people, that's for sure, because when you fail, you struggle, you kind of, you know, you're like literally grasping for breath, and that's what happened with me. I found really great people, you know, who came in at the right time. But what it actually did was, apart from making me very lighter on the pocket, I burned my entire life saving within 2 years. It actually showed me what all I shouldn't be doing in my next venture. And this venture that we are in, I'm very, very stickler to certain, you know, things that I've learned in my failures, and I don't want to do them. So apart from, so I am an optimist as far as my business is concerned, but I look at everything with a different lens. I look at it that this can fail. I never get tempted now. I used to get tempted a lot. Now it doesn't. It's a very calculated way of working. So that's kind of been.
Vivek, can you talk to us, and you told me this earlier, you said that I'm going to talk to you about speed versus perfection, okay? And you say that good today is better than perfect tomorrow. Can you share some views on that?
Yeah, I think this is something that we really follow at Chumbak, saying that start rather than think about stuff. And mistakes are something that we really encourage, you know. I don't think one would, one learns a lot more having made mistakes rather than having perfectly gone through stuff. I think making mistakes shows that you're taking risks, thinking outside the box, and you know, really putting yourself out there. The other thing that you know, the thing about good today and is better than perfect tomorrow, is that in today's competitive world, one wants to be first to market in, you know, in your GTM, whatever that you're doing, and we figure that. Why wait for, you know, the perfect business plan? Why wait for the perfect moment? Why wait for stuff? The world will pass you by. So we're always encouraging people at Chumbak, saying that just start stuff. We'll figure out the process as we, you know, get along. And I think more often than not, some of our great ideas and some of our great successes have come from this thing that, you know, let's not wait and overthink stuff. So I think, yeah, that's...
So
that's
basically avoiding analysis paralysis.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Arun, now this is fascinating. You worked for an e-commerce firm in Australia.
Yes.
Before Yatra Chef. And Yatra Chef is your first entrepreneurial venture.
Yes, yes.
That e-commerce firm, I am sure, had nothing to do with serving food on local trains and long-distance trains in India. Tell us about that transition and what drove you towards this.
Yeah, precisely. I was working in an e-commerce company in Sydney, which was selling IT equipments. And the thing is, for IT equipments, you got a very good, I mean, at least a week's time for delivery. They didn't have Amazon there back then. For us, it's just a 5 to 10 minutes window for delivery. That's all we get. So the transition has been, it was a steep learning. I mean, there were lots to learn, and we made lots of mistakes. We lost almost 6 months due to mistake, but then we learned from all that, and the transition, I wouldn't say it was easy, but it was steady, and we learned a lot from that. And as far as the customer base in both India and Australia is concerned, Australians have a lot of Asians there. We have Indians, both haggle. So the customer base is almost similar, so we didn't have to worry about that. But the food and IT, that was the thing in which I had to, you know, really learn a lot from.
Abhishek, this is your first entrepreneurial venture. Will this be your last?
blood pressure and I are partners for a long time. So yes, I will always be an entrepreneur. I can't move back.
Okay, Sagar, I've got you as the last respondent on this section, and you started out without working for a single day in your life. Okay, for anyone. In fact, you started your idea, and you started work on your idea even before your graduation results came in. So what were you, 21 years old at that time?
Yeah, true.
Yeah, 22. Okay. And even before your graduation results were out, and
You didn't care if you passed or failed, or you weren't planning beyond that, bottom line. And you got in and you started this venture. What was your number one motivation at that time?
See, basically at that point of time, it was following the heart. We wanted to build a brand. With food, it's very easy to build a brand because food goes by word of mouth. You don't need to publicize. Today, if you like my food, you'll go and tell your friends and they'll go and tell their friends. So food really goes by the word of mouth. So building a brand through the medium of food was the easiest route for us. I was very passionate about marketing and brand building since school days, college days. I would admire brands. I would, you know, draw logos of different brands in my books while studying. So branding has always been my passion, has been within me. Now, the fear of failure was never there with us. You know, I mean, we our results were not out. There was no fear of failure. Failure was never a barrier for us. I mean, we had nothing to do. I mean, there was no family to support. So that fear of failure, and you know, when the mind is without fear, you perform better. You just follow your heart. And today, that's taught me something in life. Today, I'm at a position where if I take risk, there is a fear of failure. But I don't feel scared. I mean, by God's grace, I'm happy. I'm lucky because it. I mean, my past has taught me that when the mind is without fear, you make things happen. So I just go with the flow, and I hope I never feel scared ever in my life for anything.
I love that line. You know, my boss keeps telling me that failure is not an option. Here's one guy who said failure is not a barrier, and I think that's a very interesting line. I'm going to put each one of you on the spot now, and this is the last question I have for you guys before we open it up to the audience, is to say that if there was one idea from here that you could bet on and put your money on, other than of course your own, which idea would it be? I'm going to start from here, Vivek, and then I'm going to go down.
Beer. I'd drink some more beer.
Sorry?
Beer.
Beer, okay.
Yeah, the same, beer.
Same, cheers.
You can't say that.
No, no. I'm going to do Yatra Chef, but I'm going to just call it beeryatra.com.
So are you going to serve beer at different stations?
Beer at every station.
At every station.
I'd love to be a mentor like him, you know, just guide.
Who do you bet on?
I've made an observation. I'm going for shoe repairs.
Fantastic. Oh.
You have a customer waiting right beside you.
Super. Okay, I hope you guys have enjoyed this part of the session. We'd like to open it up to the audience now. Okay. Srinath, do you want to?
We'll keep it kind of as light and as cheerful as he has made it out to be. So any questions, fire at the audience. You'll have to come up to the mic here to ask the question. So just raise your hand and you can take each of the mics. So come up in the front and ask those questions. You can actually pose a question to him as well. So,
okay.
I don't have even a 1,000 rupee idea.
My name is Deep. I'm a consultant in Silicon Valley. So the question I have is that, you know, in Silicon Valley, we have VCs that are really VCs. In India, the VCs are nothing but glorified bankers. You know, as the entrepreneurs on the panel have been expressing their frustration, they have been going through. So that stifles entrepreneurs. So could you have each of the panelists or whoever wants to talk about this aspect, that seed money, angel money is very difficult to come by in India. And people have talked about, you know, accessing their families and whatnot. So if they could talk a bit about that. Thank you.
Who would like to take that?
I can take that.
Sure, okay.
So I think two things about, you know, that each level that you, each round that you raise. Typically the first round is friends, family, your own, and you know, whatever you've got. So we have, for the start of Chumbak, we sold our house, which we had. And we sustained that for about 2.5 years. Before figuring that, listen, we're reaching a point where we're making money, we're profitable, and let's go in for the first, you know, a seed kind of fund, kind of a raise. Except that we ended up raising a proper Series A with one of the venture capitalists here. I think we've just come off a Series B with a much larger US, China, India-based VC. I think each quality that the VC brings in at different levels is extremely different. Like, for example, the VC that we've got right now is a lot more strategic. They're not just banks. Money is easy to come by if you've got a great idea, if you've got a great team and a great product. But, I mean, with a lot of greats, but VCs do add a lot of strategic value to your, to the board and to the company. And it depends on, as I'm saying, which part of your company and in its life cycle do they come in? In the first part, you need someone who's just holding your hand and just staying off and saying that, you know, you go run, you execute. I'm not going to interfere. To me, that's a great VC at that level. At the next level, when you reach, you need strategic input saying that, you know, hey, this is awesome, focus, do this better, do that better, and this is with our years of experience with the companies that we've done. So I think it's not true that they're just banks. I mean, at least in my personal case. So.
One thing I wanted to add to that, which happened yesterday, I was with our VC yesterday, and very peculiarly, they said, we can't control, we can't operate, we don't know how to do your business, that's why we're giving you the money to do the business, otherwise we would have done your business. But something really remarkable, he said, that, you know, we have 500 companies on our board, or we have 500 portfolio companies, and there are 300, 400 who have gone bust. That's the cycle of a VC. He says, the least I can tell you is what went wrong with those 300. And that's something you'll never get. Without, you could pay McKinsey, you could pay anybody, any amount of money, but you never get what happened to those 300 companies when went bust. VC tells you that, and that actually came out as absolutely one of the most rewarding things for me.
Questions? We have more. Yeah, sir, you come up, and we'll take yours next. Yeah, go ahead.
Hello. Hello. Yeah, my name is Anik Banerjee. I just wanted to ask you, all of you, at what point do you, now that you're into a business, you're very young, so you'll be doing everything yourself, I mean, all the decision making and all that. At what point of time you think a business should, you know, should hire more professionals and, you know, the decision making should go more to the professionals?
In effect,
which kind of arenas?
In effect, he's asking when do processes start coming in? When do you adopt processes and management style?
He's asking when can people like me come and work for people like you?
See, I am a very strong believer of, you know, systems, SOPs in place. But then to have those systems and SOPs, you require volumes. And volumes will only happen with expansion. So you need to reinvent yourself from time and again, I mean, from time to time. You know, when you have 5 outlets and when you have 10 outlets, the systems will change. And when you are a first generation entrepreneur, there'll be a lot of trial and error. But this trial and error will teach you a lot. Now, talking about coming from micromanage to macromanage, I think that's what your question was, sir. You know, when you are a startup, everything is with you. You are the lifeline of your business, okay? And you have to transform your passion amongst your entire team from the highest level to the lowest level, from the managers to the service executives also, you know? So from the transformation from the micromanage to the macromanage is a continuous process over a period of time. You cannot say, ki after 20 stores, I'll give it to a CEO and I'll move out of it. No, it's a proper time-consuming, process-consuming thing. You have to invest your time, your energy, your passion, everything into it, and you have to create replacements for yourself. The minute you're able to create replacements for yourself and you're able to teach your team to create replacements for yourself, you're bound to make it big. So it's a continuous process, I guess.
If it becomes a family business and the family starts fighting, that's pretty much the time to also give it to professionals.
I think Rahul, him, not me.
Hi, this is Vishal Choksi, and my question is to Rahul. So what went wrong in the past, and what were the concepts that you launched? If you can enlighten, I hope you don't mind me asking this.
So I'll give you one of them. One was called Golf Works, which is the world's largest indoor golf facility. We spent 18 crores making it. We don't own a single rupee out of that, so that's 18 crore gone down the drain. I have a colleague and partner here who burned 10 crores out of that. He's laughing away somewhere there. That's why I got him to the retail forum. See how we burn your money. But so that was one. So it was a great idea. Everybody said golf is the best thing to happen. People don't play golf. You should be able to enable golf. When I started putting golf up there, people were like, oh, I have a backache. I can't move. I don't think I can do this and all. And the moment we would launch a whiskey or a cigar, there would be queues. People would say, oh, I'll bring my friend, I'll bring another friend. I realized here people are here for alcohol, no golf. People want their booze, nobody wants golf. So we realized it's going to be booze business come what may. Indians do not believe in health at all. I just came to that point. So obviously after burning that. But yes, on a numerical way, it was very large in size, 55,000 square foot, crazy capexes, 150 staff people, you know, world's best facilities. It didn't work well. The other business was another around golf, so, you know, offline I can tell you, but yes, that's where it kind of
went. But you
went
tried Golf Works in Delhi, obviously.
Yeah, it was, sorry?
Golf Works was in Delhi?
It was in Gurgaon, yes. It was, Gurgaon. Yeah, 6 simulator bays, 9-hole indoor putting green, 32 brands of retail, the works. You can't get anything better than that.
So you did scale first before you decided that the business was not.
Yeah. Order.
All right. Any more questions? I have a question for you. So you deal with corporate owners, brand owners, and try to sell them activation ideas. Listening to all of them, how critical, from a pure marketing and brand push point of view, are innovations from your genre of business? Because eventually, they have a natural affinity to customers. Let's say beer has, or Momo has, or food on the railways has, shoe repair has. How critical is that extra value add in marketing and brand for them to become that billion-dollar idea? Right now, they are not, as you rightly said.
See, I'll tell you what. I don't think any of you can afford an advertising campaign, quite frankly, because these campaigns are expensive. They require print spends and television spends and so on. At the same time, what you need to do is that you cannot create a billion-dollar brand based on a functional attribute. You must occupy an emotional space in the mind of your consumer. It is very important. You must become a lovable brand. I'll give you an example. Let's take an example. Let's say the Zuzus, for example. Okay, Zuzus, I mean, quite frankly, if I made a Zuzu film, half of you wouldn't even be able to guess what function or feature or value-added service that Zuzu's talking about. But that Zuzu just made Vodafone as a brand an incredibly lovable brand. Some people create content that makes brands edgier and so on and so forth, right? So I think from an activation perspective or from a marketing perspective, what is the type of content that you can create that creates a story around your brand, and how can you put that up on the digital space, which is a lot more affordable than television and other forms of media, and create great content? Today, you find some brands doing some fascinating work in this space. I don't know how many of you have seen the new Nescafe thing which has just come out. I think that is beautiful. It is just a simple piece of content. How many of you have seen the Lifebuoy Roti campaign? Just pieces of content, the Vodafone earmuffs, etc. These are all pieces of content that are doing the rounds, makes the brand more lovable. And I think if you are able to do that, and brands like Coca-Cola and certain brands in Unilever spend millions of dollars just in trying to increase brand love, because beyond a certain point, I can't tell you that my shampoo is better or my cold drink is better than the other guys, right? I have to create that emotional space. And that is what, if you start investing in that, you will suddenly start occupying a very different space. Otherwise, what stops another brand from coming in and making momos as tasty as yours and getting all your customers? Or what gets somebody else to start a beer cafe and go there, right? You have to create something in them, and therefore you must invest ahead of the curve in creating that stickiness and that love.
Also because the entry barriers in each of their businesses is quite low in that sense. And if the brand affinity and the brand love is not there.
Absolutely, absolutely.
All right, before I end this session, two questions. Are you guys tired of listening to us talk? Come on, say it, I know you are. Of course you are. Because in the next session, you will have a leadership performer who will not talk. So I especially urge you all to show up at the hangar at 7 o'clock sharp to listen to this one guy from South Africa called Steve Barnett. You have to see him perform, and he's not going to dance or he's not going to do anything, but he's going to talk to you without talking. The world's only non-speaker speaker is going to perform at 7, right? 7 o'clock. Second, who wants to win a Samsung phone? That's it? Everybody else has a phone? You want a Samsung phone? Anyone wants a Samsung phone for free? For free? Come on, guys. Okay. Hop across to the stall in the next room and put your name in the lucky draw, because they are giving out the Samsung Galaxy S5, I'm told, which is a good phone. But on that note, Rahul, thank you so much. All the panelists, thank you so much. A huge round of applause for all of them for signing off this day with a fantastic session. I learned a lot about beer anyways.